Alhamdulillah, we're right on the precipice. We are right at the edge of this blessed month. The month of mercy, a month of opportunity, a month of transformation, the month of Ramadan. And so we should remember that the Prophet ﷺ described this month as what?
إِذَا جَاءَ رَمَضَانَ فُتِّحَتْ أَبْوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ وَغُلِّقَتْ أَبْوَابُ النَّارِ وَصُدِّفَتْ الشَّيَاطِينَ
The Prophet ﷺ described it as what? When the month of Ramadan comes, the gates of mercy are opened, the gates of hell are locked up, and the devils are chained. Subhanallah. This is a time to focus and receive Allah's mercy. This is a time to get closer to your Lord. This is a month, one month out of the year, where we get really serious. And we ask ourselves, how important is this deen to me? How much am I going to get focused? What am I going to accomplish this month? What goals am I going to set? What is my daily routine going to look like? And how well will I stick to it so that by the time the end of this month arrives and by the time we are celebrating Eid al-Fitr, I'll be able to celebrate not just the fact that I fasted this month, but that I accomplished my goals. Whether it be praying every night tarawih, whether it be memorizing a certain amount or reading a certain amount every day, whether it be even listening to a lecture series on a particular topic that is interesting to you, whether it is praying in the masjid a certain amount of times a day, whatever the case is, I think we all need to set certain goals and aim to achieve something great. هَلْ عِنْدَكُمْ سِرٌ مَعَ اللَّهِ There's a beautiful nasheed. And it goes, it says, do you have a secret with Allah? What is your secret with Allah? Is there something that you do privately? Is there something that you do to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is there something that you're going to make part of your schedule for this next month, for this entire month of Ramadan? That you're going to say, Ya Allah, between me and you, this is just for you. This is just between us. For this entire month, this is the practice I want to have. I don't need to tell anybody about it. I don't need to talk about it. But I want to have something that is just between us for this special month. Ask yourself if you have it. What is the objective of this month? What is the goal of Ramadan? Many people have many different opinions or many different answers. You know, sometimes non-Muslims, oh, you're not eating? Why not? Oh, it's Ramadan. Yeah, why? Why do you fast? Oh, well, people give all sorts of answers. And sometimes they're nice answers, but they're not the answer that Allah gives. Like for instance, sometimes people will say, oh, we fast so that we can understand what it feels like to be hungry, so that we can be like, you know, more empathetic towards the poor. It's a beautiful answer. And definitely it is a result of fasting, no doubt. But that's not what Allah describes in the Quran. That is not the primary objective. Allah Ta'ala tells us what? بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون Allah Ta'ala in no uncertain terms, in very clear language, tells us exactly what is the objective of Ramadan. First, Allah says, O you who have believed, calling to the believer, saying what? If you're a believer, this month is necessary to fast. If you want to be counted as the believers, then this is what you will do. Otherwise, don't count yourself from amongst the believers. So this call of Ya أيها الذين آمنوا should be taken seriously, because anybody who says that they're a believer wants to say whatever comes next, I'm going to do it. Whatever Allah commands or forbids, I'm either going to do or I'm going to avoid. And so you pay close attention. And so what does Allah say? كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ That fasting has been prescribed upon you. The language of it is beautiful. Allah could have said, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ الصِّيَامُ Allah could have said that Allah has decreed fasting. But instead, Allah said, it has been prescribed upon you. The passive form. مَمْنِي لِلْمَجْهُولِ Why does Allah use the passive form? Because this is in keeping or in theme. This is the same theme as the month of mercy. It is not harsh language. It's not strong language saying, Allah has decreed it upon you. Allah is saying, it has been prescribed for you. It has been decreed upon you. And so the passive is more of a subtle approach in line with the month of mercy. And also because, alhamdulillah, this is a time when the believers, they don't struggle as much. Of course, yes, there are some Muslims that don't fast, but the majority of Muslims, even those who commit all sorts of haram, ma'asi, disobedience throughout the year, you find that this is a time where people truly transform. People turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So harsh language is not necessary. Allah uses soft terms and says, this is the time you fast, and alhamdulillah, the ummah comes together and we fast. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ Just as it was prescribed to the people before you. In other words, this is something that was for all times and all places. This is a universal. And this is something that we can take from the past that is of benefit, that will benefit us today. You know, oftentimes people say, I wish we could go to the past. I wish we could live like old times, you know. It would be so much simpler back then. But at the same time, they don't want to get rid of their technology. They don't want to get rid of their conveniences. We all enjoy the things that we enjoy, right? So what you're really saying is, I wish we could have the best of both worlds. I wish we could still enjoy the conveniences we have today, but also develop the practices that were the best for the people of the past. This is kind of what is being implied. And subhanAllah, this is exactly what this ayah is telling us. You can live today but you can also benefit by practicing the best of practices that were passed on from generations before us, and that is fasting. And then finally, we get to the point where Allah says what? Oh, you have believed. Fasting has been prescribed upon you as it was prescribed to those before you. Why? What is the point? What is the objective? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So that you develop taqwa. This is the goal. Whenever a non-Muslim asks you at work or at school, why do you guys fast? To develop taqwa. Now, you might say, well, I don't want to tell them taqwa. They don't understand what this word means. So what does it mean? Taqwa comes from the verb, the root verb, waqa. Waqa means to protect. Ittaqa or taqwa means self-protection. In other words, you are protecting yourself, you are guarding yourself from what? From Allah's punishment, from Allah's anger. This is what is implied by taqwa. And so it can be translated as God consciousness. It can be translated as being God-fearing. Or it could be called self-restraint. And that's what I'm going to talk about as today. Self-restraint, holding yourself back from what? From crossing Allah's boundaries and limits. This is the objective behind Ramadan. Developing a sense of self-restraint, taqwa, holding yourself back from evil, so that you don't cross Allah's boundaries. How do you develop this taqwa? Well, it's quite straightforward. If you can develop the strength and the character to say no to the most basic instincts, to the most basic desires that you have, like for example, food and drink and intimacy with one spouse, if you can hold off and say no to those things, then yes, naturally, by training yourself for a full month, then what do you develop? Self-restraint. You develop taqwa. Of course, there are different levels of this type of a fast. There is the most basic and the most necessary, which is what? Staying away from the physical aspects. Like we said, food, drink, intimacy. This is just the physical realm. But then you can take it later to the verbal or mental realm, which is what? Staying away as well from argumentation, backbiting, watching things that you shouldn't be watching, listening to things that you should not be listening to. And then there is a third layer, an even higher level. And what is that? That is not only to stay away from things that are forbidden, whether it be the physical substances of eating and drinking and so forth, and not only the you know, you can say mental aspects of looking at things or talking about things that are haram, but even distractions. This is the highest level. Fasting during this month implies what? I want to stay away from anything that is a distraction, even if it's halal. Let's say, for example, a sport. It's not haram to know, you know, who won, who lost a certain sport. It's not haram. But during this month, I want to stay away from that. You know why? Because it's not helping me remember my Lord. It is just a distraction. Same thing with, I don't know, maybe you're into cars and you like to read car magazines. But you know what? I'll leave that off. During this month, I'm just going to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because learning about cars is haram, it's perfectly halal. But the issue is, I don't want to be distracted this month. I want to be focused. I want to be completely geared towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This should be our goal this month, inshallah ta'ala. Why? To develop this self-restraint. Throughout the year, if you are the type of person who, alhamdulillah, living in luxury, living in affluence, you always have food available, you always have drink available, and every single time your body says, I'm hungry, okay, I'm going to feed you. I'm thirsty, okay, I'm going to give you something to drink. If every single time you have an impulse, you obey that impulse, and you give into it immediately, then what is the result? You develop a certain level of enslavement. And shaitan uses that to make sure that you develop this habit of what? Impulse satiation. Impulse satiation. The moment I feel something, I have to immediately give into it. This is exactly what shaitan wants you to develop and get used to. And the month of Ramadan is there to break that. To break that cycle. To break that pattern. To develop the ability to hear what your body is saying. And to respond to your body by saying what? I hear you loud and clear. I know that you want this. I understand what you want. The answer is no. The answer is simply no. It's going to bother you, you're going to be annoyed, and we're both going to suffer together, but that's what it is. Get used to it. How can we help ourselves to develop this strength? What means can we use? One way is to simply analyze the way you frame your own hunger. How do you frame it? How do you describe it? What words do you use? Let's take a second to really pay attention to the language we use when we describe our hunger. Sometimes we say, I'm hungry. As if all of you is the essence of hunger. I am hungry. I'm hungry right now. I'm thirsty, right? But you know, you could just simply change the wording and it has a very big impact on your mentality. Instead of saying, I'm hungry, you say what? I'm feeling hungry. It makes a big difference. Because now you've reduced it to your essence, I am hungry, to a feeling. And a feeling is much smaller. There's another way of saying it. My body is feeling hungry. And then, wait a second, is it your entire body? No. It's not like your hands feel hungry. Your feet don't feel hungry. So another way of saying it is what? My stomach, or maybe just a portion of my stomach, is telling me that I feel hungry. Now, I know this might seem a little bit cumbersome as a sentence, and it might seem a little bit, you know, unnecessary or redundant or whatever the case is. But I hope you can appreciate what we're doing by framing it this way. You are removing yourself from the shahwa. You are removing it from your essence, from your consciousness, from your ruh, and you're recognizing that you can analyze your impulses as a separate entity. You can remove it from yourself and look at it. Instead of saying, I am hungry, I can say, no. There's just certain signals that I am hearing, I am feeling, I am sensing from my body, from a very particular part of my body, that is nagging me and saying, you're hungry. But you know what? The moment I isolate it, the moment I analyze it, instead of saying that I am hungry, but I say that, no, I'm just feeling, or I'm getting the sensation, or my stomach is telling me that I'm feeling hungry, now what have you done? You've gained control over it. And this translates to all sorts of aspects of your life. I'm angry? No. This guy said something offensive, and I can feel my anger rising. But I have control over it. It's not that I am anger. I am not angry. No, but I can feel my heart rate going up. I can feel my adrenaline kicking in. I can feel my breathing increase. I can feel my posture changing. I can feel my eyes squinting. I know what's happening to my body, but you know what? I'm still in control. Because I can analyze. Instead of everything just happening, I'm analyzing it, paying attention to it, and therefore you gain control over it. Instead of seeing someone of the opposite gender, beautiful, etc., saying, I want that person. No, I can feel myself being drawn to that person. I can feel the desire, but you know what? I can also analyze it. I can pay attention. What's happening right now? What is this feeling? And then you can say, you know what? I can also control it. This is the objective behind Ramadan. Gain a little bit of control. Stop being enslaved to your desires. Don't think to yourself, I am hungry and I am angry and I am this or that or the other. Rather, learn to say that the me, the essence of who I am, that is my ruh, that is my soul, that is my consciousness, and my body, it may have all sorts of signals, but I can interpret those signals. And I can analyze them and I can either choose to obey or choose not to. I have self-mastery and self-control. That is the objective here. And this is not just from my own personal opinion. SubhanAllah, the way Allah Ta'ala describes the nafs, He uses the lam al-ahd, the an-nafs. It's so beautiful in the ayah when Allah says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ Allah says, what? But as for he who fears the standing before his Lord, and he prevents the soul. Not his soul, not his self, but rather an-nafs. And the wording of this, when you look into tafsir, they mention it's almost as if it's being isolated as a separate entity. Whatever my shahawat tell me, I have to stop and analyze them as a separate entity. It's not that I am these desires, but I have control over these desires. I can analyze them, I can interpret them, and I can choose to obey or not. What is the reward for such a person who can actually prevent his soul from his inclinations? فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى Then indeed, paradise will be his refuge. SubhanAllah. May Allah Ta'ala make us of those who develop self-restraint. Amin ya Rabbil Alameen. Inshallah, we'll continue in the second khutbah. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ تَسْلِيمًا كَثِيرًا بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله A few more tips that we can learn when it comes to self-discipline and self-restraint is knowing your purpose. When you have no purpose during your day, then you're just gonna be pushed around by your base carnal desires. Why? Eat something, you'll eat. Eat a little more, take another bite, take another slice. Okay, why not? I don't have anything else to do. I don't have any objective in life. I don't have any purpose or goal, so I might as well just keep saying yes to whatever impulses I have. But the one who has a purpose, the one who knows what his goal is when he wakes up in the morning, the one who knows that his goal is to get closer to his Lord, that life in and of itself has its own purpose, and that he hasn't been put on this earth to just eat, or to just consume, to just be a consumer. When you have that as a reality in your mind, then you look at the food and you say to yourself, look, I've eaten enough, I'm satiated, I don't need to keep eating, I'm not here just to eat. And then it becomes a lot easier to say, you know what? No, thank you. I don't think I'm gonna have a second and third and fourth slice. I wasn't created to just eat. I have a higher purpose than that. So this can help. Another thing that can help is what? Take responsibility for your own actions. It's unfortunate that oftentimes people will play the blame game when it comes to obeying their base desires. When they lack self-discipline and self-control and self-restraint, they point the finger to everybody else. I was born this way. Everybody else is doing it. I got this from my parents. I got this from my family. I got this from my environment, and so on and so on and so forth. Recognize that you have free will and that you are responsible to take responsibility for your own actions. And also always remember that anytime you give in to certain desires and you waste your time doing something that is of no benefit, you have effectively said no to an infinite number of other possibilities. Everything else you could be doing, you just said no to. And oftentimes we forget this. If you decide to say, you know what, I'm gonna, go on Netflix or play this video game or waste my time chatting with this person or that person, and you waste hours and hours and hours of your life. Oftentimes you're so busy thinking about the thing that you're engaged in, you're not thinking about, hey, didn't I start that book and I never finished it? Wasn't I supposed to exercise and then I'm just getting less and less healthy? Didn't I say I should spend more time with my family and I'm just completely neglecting them and our relationships are rotting? Didn't I say I was gonna memorize that surah and I never got around to it? Oh, am I not missing my salawat? Am I not missing my prayers? Didn't I say I was going to start getting serious about my prayers and now I forgot to do that? And this is why throughout the Quran you find multiple instances where the people of taqwa are also described in maybe the very next ayah as the muhsinun or muhsineen. You find that this concept of taqwa and ihsan go hand in hand. Why is that the case? Why is that the case? Because taqwa is what you're not doing. Taqwa is about saying no to evil. But the moment you say no to evil, you're also saying yes to what? Excellence. And this is a muhsin. So for instance, there are many, I have several different examples. I'll just point to perhaps one. Allah Ta'ala says what? وَالَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصِّدْقِ وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ ذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. SubhanAllah. Why does Allah describe them with two different descriptions? Allah says what? And the one who has brought the truth and they who believe in it, those are the muttaqoon. Those are the people of taqwa, those who believe in the truth. Then Allah continues to say, they will have whatever they desire with their Lord. That is the reward for the muhsineen. That is the reward for the people of ihsan. So they've been described in two different ways, back to back. Ahl taqwa and then what? Ihsan with muhsineen. Why is that the case? Because it's two sides of the same coin. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. When you're described with taqwa, that's because you have the ability to say no to evil. But the moment you say no to evil, it's not like you just freeze in time. You do something, but it's not evil. So what are you doing? You're doing excellence, you're doing good. So we should always keep this in our minds. We should always do our best to remember, when I say yes to an evil thing, I'm saying no to all the potential good that I could have done. When you keep this in your mind, it becomes a lot easier, inshallah ta'ala, to say no to evil and to develop a sense of taqwa and self-restraint. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. The final point that I'd like to mention, the final hadith I'd like to mention, is that the Prophet ﷺ, when he was asked, سُئِلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَنْ أَكْثَرِ مَا يُدْخِلُ النَّاسَ الْجَنَّةَ, that the Messenger ﷺ was asked, what is the thing that enters people into paradise the most? What enters people into paradise the most? The Prophet ﷺ said, what? تَقْوَى اللَّهُ وَحُسْنُ الْخُلُقُ. Again, you find these two coming together. تَقْوَى اللَّهُ وَحُسْنُ الْخُلُقُ. That fear of Allah, this is the restraint part, this is what you don't do. حُسْنُ الْخُلُقُ, this is what you do. Good character, right? This combination is entering the most amount of people into paradise. But then I want you also to pay attention to the second part of the hadith. Then he was asked, وَسُئِلَ عَنْ أَكْثَرِ مَا يُدْخِلُ النَّاسَ النَّارِ. He was asked, what is the thing that enters the people into the fire the absolute most? And then he also mentioned two things. الْفَمْ وَالْفَرْجِ. The mouth and the private parts. That which is between the jaw, that which is between the legs. And so, if I could highlight anything as we enter into this month of Ramadan, I would hope that we can use this opportunity as a time to say no, to learn taqwa, as Allah describes, this is the objective. Learn self-restraint, learn to say, these are Allah's limits and I'm not going to cross them. Learn to listen to your body saying, I want this, and say, I hear you. The answer is no, I'm not giving in. This is what we need to develop, especially with regards to two places. The tongue, backbiting, lying, gossiping, speaking, saying things you shouldn't be saying, speaking authoritatively about topics you have no knowledge of. Learn to control the tongue, and then that which is between the legs. If you are involved in any sort of haram relationship, if you are watching things you should not watch, listening to things you shouldn't listen to, and so on and so forth, things that are of an explicit and sexual nature, this is the time to what? This is the time to say no. This is a month to get serious and to strengthen yourself. And may Allah Ta'ala give us the strength to gain command and control over our tongues and our private parts. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Now before I close, I do also want to mention that the board has a few quick announcements that are very important, that inshallah ta'ala we will be praying Salat al-Taraweeh in the new masjid, which means that at 9:30 you'll be able to enter into the new masjid and pray Isha and then pray Taraweeh. Now, a few points need to be mentioned. Firstly, this doesn't mean you can go in whenever you want, okay? It's under construction, so therefore you can't just walk in at all times and you know of the day and night. We will be praying Taraweeh there. We'll also be praying Jum'ah there during the month of Ramadan. But other than that, please do not go in that area. Furthermore, when you enter, there's the lobby and then there's going to the gymnasium area. Other than that, the place is still under construction. If we have people roaming around, oh, I feel like exploring, so forth, so on and so forth, that's a very good way to either break things, to get in sort of all sorts of trouble, and to make all sorts of problems, people get injured, etc. So please, let's have a little bit of taqwa, self-restraint, and say, you know what, I'm restricting myself to 9:30 until the end of Taraweeh, from the lobby to the gym, and that's it. Furthermore, nobody under 12 years old, because young kids, they can't be controlled so much and they want to go explore and touch things. Furthermore, Do not go to the back area close to the water. It's going to be a beautiful, nice night. It's going to be warm, beautiful, nice breeze, probably full moon, shimmering off the water. You're probably going to want to hang out there. The answer is, unfortunately, no. We're not supposed to do that. Why? Because it's an area that is still under construction, no matter how tantalizing it may be. Please have a little bit of self-restraint and say, no, you know what? I'm not going to do that. If you want to stay and continue after 8 raka'ah, you can here in this physical location, not over there. So you pray your tarawih up until 8 raka'ah, and they say, subhanAllah, I want to keep worshiping all night. Great. Walk across the street, come inside, stay as long as you want, inshallah ta'ala, not over there. So I hope those points are clear. Oh, and finally, last point is, I don't know why, but some people, they don't like to listen to the volunteers. It seems a little bit odd sometimes when the volunteers say, please brother, can you stand here? Can you go there? They're like, no, I do whatever I want. I don't know where this comes from. I don't know what's going on, but I just hope that everybody understands that if everybody has their own set of rules, the world is going to be chaos, right? We're in a construction zone area. Everybody can't be like, I'm doing my own renegade sort of, you know, attitude. It doesn't work like that. We need rules, we need guidelines, and so please, we have volunteers for a reason. We come to certain rules for a reason. Please try not to be the lone wolf or whatever you think you are. Please abide by the rules and regulations, and simply listen when you're asked to stand in a certain way or et cetera, et cetera. Please do so, so that we can get along peacefully. Jazakumullahu khairan. So finally, may Allah ta'ala make us of those who learn taqwa during this month. May Allah ta'ala make us of those who have self-restraint. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us develop this self-restraint throughout this month. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us stronger so that we can avoid crossing His limits. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma hadina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa barik lana fi ma a'tayt, wa qina sharra ma qadayt. Fa innaka taqdi wa la yuqda alayk, innahu la yadhillu man walayt, wa la ya'izzu man adayt, barakta rabbana wa ta'alayt. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana, wa fil akhirati hasana, wa qina adhaban nar, wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima kathira, wa aqim الصلاة.